It's the Ricky Smiley Morning Show.
Yeah, man. Praise the Lord.
Yes.
And let everybody know your stance on that and why.
Definitely. We have to realize that marriage is an economic institution. It's a business arrangement. Yes, there's love involved. There's sex. There's commitment. There's intimacy. Okay? But at the end of the day, it's about business. Why do we say that? When people get divorced and you go into a divorce court, how often do you see people looking to divide up the love? How often do you see people looking to divide up the commitment, the intimacy? They're not looking to divide up emotions. They're looking to divide up wealth, assets, real estate, businesses, property. And so when a black male marries a white woman, when most of the time he's marrying down in socioeconomic status and the white woman is marrying up. And so we have to look at the black man being married to the white woman as what it really is, an economic divestment away from the black community and an economic investment into white people. In other words, you're taking from people who have been robbed enough and you're giving to people who have already taken too much.
All right. If anybody want to have a conversation with Dr. Umar Johnson or call in and leave a comment, and Dr. Umar Johnson is on the show today, call right now, 866-9-RICKY, 866-9-R-I-C-K-E-Y, Rick Smiley Morning Show.
It's the Ricky Smiley Morning Show.
Yeah, man. Praise the Lord.
EY, Dr. Umar Johnson is on with us this morning. Who do you have?
We got Shay on the line from Little Rock, Arkansas. Good morning.
Good morning.
Hey, Shay, you are on with Dr. Umar Johnson. Go ahead.
Yes, Dr. Umar. I know you were talking about, you know, little black boys and ADHD, but I actually have a 10-year-old daughter who was diagnosed with depression. And, you know, I talk to my family all the time about, you know, what I should be trying to do, but they just tell me, oh, girl, you know, depression isn't real. I mean, you know, like black people just always like, oh, depression, that girl just need more structure. And, you know, it's a real thing in our home. So, like, suggestions, she's on medication right now and it's helping, but like any suggestions I can do, especially since I don't get support from my family about it.
Okay. Well, first of all, depression is very real, and one needs to only look at the dismally high rates of childhood suicide that has been growing over the past 10, 20 years for African American children. So depression is very real, and it is characterized by negative thoughts about oneself, negative thoughts about one's life, negative thoughts about one's future. But because she's a child, the question becomes, what dysfunction is taking place in the family system that is triggering these negativistic beliefs? In other words, whenever a child has any kind of an emotional problem, you always look at the family first. Whether daddy's there, is he putting in time? Does she get quality time with mom? Could it be sibling rivalry? Could it be sibling bullying? Is it bullying going on at school? Children are not generally sad. If a child is sad, it's because something's going wrong within the family system or maybe in the school system.
Yeah, I mean, she's been going to therapy for a year. It's just my family, they just don't support me. They don't support anytime I try to talk to them about it, or I'm like, if you notice something, can you let me know? They're just like, girl, you need to make her, you know, basically make her happy. And I'm just like, I'm doing everything I can. Me and her dad is in her life. We're doing everything we can to support her, but she gets withdrawn. And, you know, it's just a lot on me because I want my child to be happy.
The other thing, too, if she's been with the same therapist for a year and you haven't seen a reduction in her depression, it's time to look for a new therapist. And I'm not sure if the therapist is African American, but if they're not, you might want to get in contact with the Association of Black Psychologists, which is based here in Maryland, and we can definitely link you up with a therapist that can help move her from where she is to where she needs to be.
Dr. Umar, shout that out one more time.
The Association of Black Psychologists, that is the National Organization of Black Psychologists based here in the Maryland, D.C. area, and anytime an African American needs a referral for therapy, they can contact ABPSY.
So you think that black people should go to a black psychologist because they probably have a better understanding of what it's like to be black and dealing with things that black people have to deal with?
Exactly, because the first rule of therapy is relationship. And in order to build a relationship with your client, you have to be able to establish rapport. And unfortunately, because of the climate of racism in America, a lot of times African-American clients report that their white therapists really can't understand them because they're too busy judging them from the lens of racism.
Right. Dr. Umar, let me ask you this. Considering the fact that it's a lot of racism going on, and I'm talking about the climate of racism is bad, is worse than I have ever seen in my whole life. How bad do you think it's going to get? What do you think it's going to come down to?
Frederick Douglass said that the limits of tyrants is prescribed by the people who they oppress. That is to say, as long as we sit down and do nothing about it, it's going to get worse. If you look at our history, whenever we were faced with this type of a situation, we rose up in unity together. Everything we've gotten through street struggle and protest. We got out of slavery through street struggle and protest, out of Jim Crow, street struggle and protest. We got the Civil Rights Bill and the Voting Rights Act because we struggled and we protested. The African American today, this 21st century Negro we have, we are very docile, we are very passive, we are very lazy, and most of all, we are very selfish. We're not as concerned about the group as we were in the 60s or the 70s. Today, it's all about me.
Right. I tell you, man, I try to get out, I tell people to go and vote. I get on this radio, I hammer and hammer and hammer on the local elections, the school board, the judges, the county commissioners, the city council, the mayor, and the turnout is low. I'm talking about super low turnout.
Well, the thing is, though, Ricky, you got to put that in context. 40% of Americans don't vote, period, black or white. And a big reason, America actually has one of the lowest voter turnout rates for democratic countries in the world. And part of that has to do with the fact rich people often don't feel like they need to vote because they're already set. And poor people often don't vote because they feel that the government doesn't care about them anyway. So you have a lot of apathy at both ends of the spectrum. But one thing we have to do as African Americans, we have to start voting together in unison so that our vote can be heard. As long as we vote as individuals, that really doesn't benefit the community because the individual vote is an isolated schizophrenic vote. We need an organized, systematic approach to politics where our issues can be heard and at the same time backed collectively while we cast our ballots.
All right, we got Karen from Dallas. Go ahead. You're on with Dr. Johnson. Good morning.
Hi, Dr. Johnson and Ricky. Thank you for taking my call. I am a young lady. I grew up as a Christian, and I can no longer support the religion of Christianity because it sends a lot of us out to these stores for consumerism in the name of God, in the name of Jesus Christ, just like Christmas. What does that, Easter, those things are like the devil. He puts a little bit of lie. He puts a lie with a little bit of the truth. And so at this point, I'm searching. And your religion is Pan-Africanism, or can you speak to me about that? And also, one more thing, I wholeheartedly agree with you about our community, why we can't come together, because too many of us has gotten 40 acres in a mule or a lot in a Benz, and now we're removed from the struggle. How do we become together as a people? So, because there's things that's coming down that just look like we need to unite, and thank you.
No problem. Firstly, Pan-Africanism is not a religion. It's a political ideology. We believe in freedom of religion. So you can be a Muslim, as Malcolm X was. You could be a Christian, as the Honorable Marcus Garvey was. Pan-Africanism basically posits that all people of African descent are members of the same African family. We are one family. We should identify on the level of family before we identify on the level of anything else, and that we have a responsibility to solve our own problems. With regard to religion, the way I see it, as the Bible says, in my Father's house there are many mansions. So for some people, Islam is the road they need to take. For others, it's being a Jehovah's Witness. For others, it's Christian. Me personally, I study traditional African spirituality. Okay, and the difference between religion and spirituality, three quick points, is number one, in African spirituality, we look at the supreme creator of the universe in both masculine form as well as feminine form. One of our respectable criticisms for Christianity and Islam is they have taken out the divinity of the black woman, which is something that African culture and spirituality holds very sacred. Number two, we don't believe that you got to go searching for God outside of you. God is inside. So most of your work is inner work, not outer work. And then number three, whereas religion often gives you an answer for every question that you have, spirituality says you have to go and find your own answer. Spirituality is open-ended, whereas religion sometimes is closed-ended.
Hey, now this is what I have to ask you. I have to ask you this, and I struggle with this personally. Now, we have the Bible,
mm-hmm.
and we taught that Jesus Christ is the Son of God.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, white people, you know, read the same Holy Bible, King James Version, whatever. So you got the Christian right and the Ku Klux Klan and the Don't Tread on Me, and they read the same Bible, but Jesus Christ and everything in the Bible from the New Testament to the Old Testament talks about love. It talks about forgiveness or whatever. So, and I'm sitting up here thinking maybe this Bible was used as a tool to keep black folks from fighting back or from standing up for themselves and the turner of the cheek. And how real are some of the stories in the Bible? I believe in a living God. Okay. I really believe in a living God. And I know, you know, that there's a God, but what question me is some of the same people that hate black people, they are real religious Christians from the right. The Ku Klux Klan went to church every Sunday,
mm-hmm.
and Sunday night after church, they terrorized black people.
Exactly.
Can you give me your take on that? Because I'm having a hard time. I'm really struggling with the whole Christianity, and I believe in God, but I'm struggling with some of these Bible stories and Christianity and some of this stuff, because if we're reading the same Bible, if I'm not wrong, why do you hate us so bad?
Well, a couple things. Number one, the Bible is so vast, that you can find passages in the Bible, just like with any holy book, to support whatever your political economic agenda is. I could do a whole lecture on Pan-Africanism from the Bible, just like you can do a whole sermon on love. Someone could do another sermon on punishment. It's like the United States Constitution. You know, for years they argued, does the U.S. Constitution, you know, support slavery? Does it support liberation? Whenever you have a book so vast, you can always find information to support your argument. But more importantly, what we need to understand as black people is that everyone's religion supports their political economic agenda except ours. You understand? So when you look at the Ku Klux Klan, the Christian right, they're going to use the Bible to support their political economic agenda, but black people don't do that. We don't feel comfortable using our religion to support where we need to go as a people. And because of that, we have been handcuffed and straitjacketed into a colorblind multiculturalism that has spelled disaster for us. The black dollar only circulates, what, once before it leaves the community, as compared to the Jewish dollar about 15 times, Chinese dollar about 10 times. Everyone's dollar circulates at least a half dozen times before it leaves the community except ours. And the other thing too, Ricky, is we have to do a better job moving forward in the 21st century, holding the black church economically responsible,
yes.
for what it is not doing,
yes.
with our contributions.
Yes.
We give the black church $14 million every single Sunday. With that type of money, how do you explain no hospitals? How do you explain no black banks? How do you explain so few black schools? Where are our black supermarkets? Unfortunately, the black church has reinvented itself in the post-Dr. King assassination era, and it has went away from being an institution of agitation to an institution of accommodation.
Wow. Dr. Umar, please come back on the show. We got to go, but please, can you come back, man?
Oh, absolutely, Ricky. Just let me know when. I'm always in Atlanta, so I can come into the studio next time. And also, let your parents know if they ever need to reach me, any questions about their children, any questions, I hold a free Black Parent Teleconference. It's every Tuesday morning, 6 a.m. until 8 Eastern Standard Time. They can ask me anything they want for free. And the number to that call is 857-232-0158. Again, 857-232-0158. And the access code is 870-864-pound. And if they didn't get that, they can reach me at drumarjohnson.com. I'm on Twitter and Instagram at Dr. Umar Johnson. And the phone number is 215-989-9858.
Right. Dr. Umar Johnson. Hey, thank you, man.
Thank you, Rick.
We appreciate you. Thank you very
much. Take care, my brother.
There it is, y'all. Ricky Smiley Morning Show.
It's the Ricky Smiley Morning
This week on The Real Veggies of FNV. Did you
hear? We have to realize that marriage is an economic institution. It's a business arrangement. Yes, there's love involved, there's sex, there's commitment, there's intimacy, okay? But at the end of the day, it's about business. Why do we say that? When people get divorced and you go into a divorce court, how often do you see people looking to divide up the love? How often do you see people looking to divide up the commitment, the intimacy? They're not looking to divide up emotions. They're looking to divide up wealth, assets, real estate, businesses, property. And so when a black male marries a white woman, and most of the time he's marrying down in socioeconomic status, and the white woman is marrying